On the surface, the Autolyse is a simple method. Mix flour and water together, then leave it to rest. But what does the Autolyse actually do? Everywhere you go, there seems to be numerous opinions on the Autolyse and how to use it. Some say the Autolyse makes bread dough easier to stretch because of protease enzymes, while others say that it helps feed the yeast with simpler sugars. And then there are people who say the Autolyse is useless. So, what's the real science behind this seemingly simple method? What benefits does it really bring to us as home bakers? And do we really need to use it? Or are we just wasting our time with Autolyse? Today, we're going to dive into it. Serafin here. Let's talk about Autolyse. Going back to the definition, Autolyse, sometimes referred to as autolysis, is a technique in bread making where flour and water are mixed and allowed to rest before the addition of other ingredients. The term autolysis comes from the Greek words meaning self-splitting. In biology, autolysis, or self-digestion, refers to the destruction of a cell by its own enzymes. It can also describe the digestion of an enzyme by another molecule of the same enzyme. In bread making, autolyse is essentially a resting period that allows flour components to activate with sufficient hydration. Now, while obviously resting periods in bread making are not new, Professor Raymond Calvel formally identified and popularized this autolyse technique in 1974. In Professor Calvel's book, it is primarily referred to as autolysis, although he occasionally used the French word autolyse, which has since become the more common term among bakers. At that time, Autolyse was part of Professor Calvel's response to the decline in French bread quality due to the rise of mass production. This is adamantly shown in the title of one of his most popular books. The English translation of the book's title calls it The Taste of Bread, but the original French title was, pardon my French, Le goût du pain, comment le préserver, comment le retrouver, which can be roughly translated to The Taste of Bread, How to Preserve It and Recover It. At a glance, it's easy to see what the purpose of the book was, and Autolyse was one of the key methods introduced. In the decades since the book was published, Calvel's explanation of Autolyse's effects on dough rheology remains particularly interesting because it aligns with the many findings from recent studies, despite slight methodological differences. While these recent studies are extensive and detailed, utilizing state-of-the-art instruments and technology, Calvel deserves credit. He introduced the concept over 50 years ago, and recent research continues to indirectly validate his findings at microscopic and molecular levels, reinforcing the significance of his pioneering experiments. When we look at his book, it highlights how Autolyse improves hydration and gluten development, yielding more extensible dough. To talk about actual benefits, this translates to shorter mixing times, reduced oxidation, easier shaping, and improved bread quality, evident in an increased volume, a finer crumb, and softer texture. Additionally, while Autolyse generally benefits a range of breads, from standard French loaves to sandwich breads and sweet yeast doughs, Professor Calvel noted its particular advantage for sourdough bread. Modern studies on wheat dough processing confirm many of these findings, demonstrating similar improvements in hydration, gluten structure, and dough elasticity. Topics we'll delve into shortly, but first, we have to look at why Professor Calvel was championing Autolyse in his era. What problem exactly was he addressing? Well, as we said earlier, Professor Calvel was battling against the decline in bread quality due to mass production. With this context, it indicates that the technique was initially developed to address challenges in commercial baking. In his book, Professor Calvel argued that the modernization of bread making, which sped up and shortened traditional processes, was deteriorating the quality of French bread, altering its texture, flavor, and even color. Professor Calvel recounts a discussion among experts on this phenomenon, particularly the impact of intensive mixing on flour. They focused on lipoxygenase, an enzyme that catalyzes the oxidation of unsaturated fatty acids. At the time, French wheat flour was often supplemented with bean flour, a source of lipoxygenase. The experts noted that intensive mixing significantly increases lipoxygenase catalyzed oxidation due to greater air incorporation and expanded dough surface area. This leads to the formation formation of peroxides, which decompose and release volatile compounds that negatively affect bread's aroma, an undesirable outcome for consumers. This enzyme also contributes to increased bread whiteness by oxidizing carotenoid pigments in flour. But let's explore why bean flour, such as soy or fava flour, were traditionally added to wheat flour. The answer lies in flour strength, quantified by the Chopin alveograph test. This test measures dough's rheological properties by inflating a thin sheet into a bubble until rupture. By analyzing the pressure and time required for rupture, it simulates gas retention during fermentation and baking, providing a reliable assessment of flour quality. A critical output is the W index, which reflects the deformation energy needed to expand the dough, directly indicating gluten strength. Why does this matter? Well, while French flours are classified by ash content, the T number, protein content is less reliable for predicting strength due to France's predominance of softer wheat varieties. Instead, bakers rely on the W index, as mentioned, as it strongly correlates with gas retention, a decisive factor in bread quality. As Calvel notes, wheat and flour quality in France were generally poor until around 1935 to 1940. At one point, flour strength, as expressed by the W index, averaged 90 in the Parisian region and only reached 70 with difficulty in the provinces. These numbers may not sound that bad until you compare them to contemporary T55 flour, the preferred choice for traditional baguettes, which is considered a medium-strength flour with a W index ranging from 160 to 250. You can get why bakers would be very interested in methods to improve flour strength, and adding bean flour with its lipoxygenase served as a quick fix for weak flour. Its strength and effect was measurable through the Chopin alveograph test. Now you see, while we've only talked about the downsides of adding lipoxygenase to wheat flour, lipoxygenase actually play a crucial role in strengthening bread dough through a sophisticated biochemical mechanism. The enzyme's catalytic activity on polyunsaturated fatty acids leads to the production of hydrogen peroxide, which you probably recognize as a bleaching agent for clothes and hair. This hydrogen peroxide in bread dough promotes the formation of disulfide bonds within the gluten network. This increased cross-linking enhances the dough's rheological properties, improving its strength, elasticity, and mixing tolerance, ultimately contributing to superior bread quality. While lipoxygenase is naturally present in wheat flour, high-speed commercial mixing often requires additional amounts. Traditionally, it was added along with ascorbic acid. However, unlike ascorbic acid, lipoxygenase is an enzyme that persists, potentially leading to the side effects we discussed earlier. Beyond improving strength through the lipoxygenase enzyme, bean flour also acted as a carrier for cereal or fungal amylases, offering additional functional benefits. Now that we know why bean flour is added to wheat flour and how it can create adverse flavors, we have to ask, what does all this have to do with Autolyse? From Professor Calvel's book, the short answer is that in commercial baking, a big benefit of using autolyse is that it expedites the process and thus minimizes oxidation catalyzed by lipoxygenases. Autolyse shortens mixing time and as a result lowers the oxidation of the dough, something mentioned very frequently in the taste of bread. This is where the autolyse is supposed to improve the flavor of the resulting bread via the reduction of the unpleasant volatile compounds created through oxidation. The professor also notes that the dough becomes easier to handle and results in bread with better volume, among other benefits. But of course, it's been many years since the book was published, and we now know quite a bit more about bread dough. So to better understand autolyse, let's briefly discuss the scientific findings from some of the more recent studies on different dough mixing and resting processes that may shed light on how autolyse works. As I've said, this is a brief discussion. For a more detailed take on this subject, you may want to watch our videos on strain hardening that cover the many aspects of dough development. So here's what we need to know. At the start of autolyse, when we mix flour and water at room temperature, as the water is incorporated into the flour, it disperses the particles and acts as a plasticizer. This plasticization significantly reduces the glass transition temperature of the flour, transforming it from a rigid, glassy state to a more flexible, rubbery one, allowing for new interactions. This transition is crucial for the development of the gluten network. Now, water also activates endogenous naturally occurring enzymes in wheat flour, especially amylase and protease. At this early stage, though, these enzymes don't catalyze much. Amylase doesn't break down that many starch molecules in the flour, and likewise, protease enzymes haven't cleaved that many protein peptides into flavor precursors. In fact, throughout the entire autolyse process, as prepared per Professor Calvel's instructions, there isn't much enzyme activity within the given time frame. If you look at the recipes in this book, from exhibit to exhibit, you'll see that autolyse usually involves mixing flour and water slowly for 3 to 5 minutes, and then letting it rest for 15 to 30 minutes, rarely exceeding 30 minutes. Therefore, any claim that autolyse supports significant organoleptic improvements in the final product is, I think, rather weak from a scientific perspective, especially when compared to derivatives such as preferments, poulish, for example, and tangchong. Protease enzymes in poulish enjoy optimal conditions for catalyzing proteins through sufficient long fermentation that floods the mixture with yeast metabolites, which trigger biochemical reactions producing flavor precursors. In the case of tangchong, when done correctly, amylase enzymes break down starch molecules, causing a significant increase in maltose and other reducing saccharides, which contribute to the natural wheat umami of the final product. In many of my previous videos, I've covered these derivatives extensively, so we're not going to delve into the details again. However, I would like to say, if you're thinking of using autolyse to improve the flavor of your bread, you may want to consider poulish or other preferments, and tangchong for sure. I think Professor Calvel, in his book, emphasized that autolyse reduces oxidation during mixing, which preserves carotenoid pigments in the flour. This leads to a more golden crumb and a milder, sweeter taste due to less bitterness from oxidized lipids. He also emphasized using autolyse for the overall improvement of bread quality, including texture and crumb surface. These factors are intrinsically linked to flavor perception, as I've discussed in many of my previous videos. So if your flour doesn't contain high levels of amylase, then the effects of amylase during autolyse are minimal. However, protease may play a decisive role in the autolyse method, unfortunately not on the beneficial end of the spectrum. This paper reported that when the dough resting time exceeded 60 minutes, the GMP content decreased. The authors explained that this is likely due to protease and microbial activity causing partial GMP disintegration through intramolecular and intermolecular disulfide bond cleavage. We'll get to what is GMP in a moment, but from this study, we can infer that 60 minutes can serve as the upper limit for the resting period of autolyse on medium-strength flour, which was used in the experiment. It's worth noting that the typical time frame of Professor Calvel's autolyses in any of his recipes rarely exceeded 30 minutes of resting. As previously detailed in our strain hardening video series, gluten and macropolymer GMP is an important component of the gluten and protein in wheat flour, crucial for dough elasticity and bread making quality. GMP exists as polymers, part of the alcohol insoluble gluten fraction. These polymers have molecular weights in the multi-million range and may belong to the largest protein aggregates in food systems. It can be described as a gel-like network formed by a collection of very large gluten and protein aggregates, insoluble in SDS, which are best described as particles. In flour, these GMP particles are generally spherical. As flour and water combine to form dough, the mechanical action of mixing significantly impacts GMP particles. While essential for developing the initial gluten network, mixing can also depolymerize large GMP structures into smaller units. The energy input during mixing disrupts and deforms these initially spherical particles, causing them to lose their regular shape. This disruption can also lead to a decrease in their average size, as large aggregates break down into smaller SDS-soluble components. Research indicates that GMP content decreased by approximately 20.20% when mixing time increased from 3 to 5 minutes. This is significant, as Calvel's autolyse recipes specify 3 to 5 minutes of low-speed mixing. Therefore, we can infer that the GMP disruption disruption described above occurs, at least partially during the initial mixing stage of autolyse. Dough resting after mixing influences water distribution within the dough. Resting for more than 30 minutes has been shown to cause water molecules to bind more tightly with starch and protein, which is conducive to gluten network formation. As gluten proteins absorb water, more unbonded sulfhydryl groups become involved in the formation of disulfide bonds. These disulfide bonds are strong covalent linkages that cross-link glutenin molecules, significantly contributing to the strength and elasticity of the gluten network. During the resting stage, the depolymerized glutenin macromers can re-cross-link via these disulfide bonds, leading to an increase in GMP content and size. All of this leads to enhanced dough elasticity, observed as an immediate result of autolyse, and consequently, a less sticky dough. This is essentially the primary benefit autolyse delivers. Dough resting also improves extensibility. This improvement likely stems from the relaxation of the gluten structure formed during mixing, facilitating easier stretching during subsequent stages. Moreover, gliadins, primarily associated with extensibility, contribute to the dough's overall stretchability by integrating more effectively within a developed glutenin network, a process resting promotes. While all of these benefits can be attributed to autolyse, it's crucial to recognize that resting, irrespective of its placement within the bread-making timeline, demonstrably produces all of these benefits. They manifest whether resting occurs at the beginning of the dough development process in the autolyse, between sets of stretch and folds, or during bulk fermentation, yielding largely comparable outcomes. Simply put, these benefits are not exclusive to the autolyse method. Now, knowing all that we need to know, we can consider how the autolyse is used today. Although we talked about bean flours such as soy flours in commercial bread as a historical context for the autolyse method, these additions are far from a relic of the past. I found soy flour listed in the ingredients of a modern commercial bread as recently as December 2024, confirming its continued relevance. It likely still serves its original purpose, providing lipoxygenase and acting as a carrier for beneficial enzymes. So, with this in mind, I'm curious, do any large-scale commercial or industrial bread-making companies incorporate autolyse into their processes? Personally, I lean towards the pessimistic side of the answer. Here's the rationale. While autolyse is a well-established technique with clear benefits for dough hydration, gluten development, and overall bread quality, its use in commercial and industrial bread making appears limited. This is primarily due to the emphasis on speed, efficiency, and consistency in large-scale productions. High-speed mixing and dough additives offer faster, more controllable ways to achieve desired dough properties, making the time-consuming autolyse step less appealing for mass production. Again, in commercial baking, autolyse is intended to expedite the process, minimizing oxidation catalyzed by lipoxygenases. However, more efficient methods to achieve this effect exist, lessening autolyse's appeal for large-scale production. So, autolyse is like a tool to solve a problem, but the problem has already been solved by other means. For those of us baking at home or doing artisan bread, after everything we've talked about, I think we can start to see autolyse for what it really is. You know how everyone talks about all the amazing things it does? Well, when you really get into the whole bread-making process through the lens of strain hardening, you start to see it's basically just a way to jumpstart that first part of the process. And guess what? There are other ways to do that. So if you're already using autolyse and it works for you, awesome, keep at it. But if you've never tried it or it's just a pain, don't worry about skipping it. Just give your dough a little extra rest later on. Like if you're doing stretch and folds and you skip the autolyse, just throw in another round of stretch and folds, easy peasy. Look, the science behind autolyse is fine, but the most important thing to note about it is that it's not exactly unique in its benefits. You get many of the same benefits by letting the dough rest or adopting slower mixing techniques. Just by really understanding the whole bread making process from mixing to strain hardening, that's where you can make the biggest difference in your bread. Okay, that concludes our discussion for today. Thank you for watching and bye!